So what you're gonna do is,
so there's a couple announcements. First one is Miss Deanna will be teaching next Monday to the level one. So if there's anybody local that wants to come in and join, Deanna, I know, would like to have the support. And also, Cindy will be sending out the link probably sometime over the weekend for the level one class, so you guys can access it that way. Hi, Osborne. The other, and Deanna, that's on Untangling the Mess.
Untangling the Mess.
Untangling the Mess.
Yeah.
So we'll be teaching on that on Monday. The other thing that's exciting that we were just having a meeting on was the treasure sale for the international conference in Uganda in October. They are going to be doing the treasure sale again. I guess it's been, I think Bonda said this morning, it was like 15 years since the last one. So she's asking people to pray about your treasures that you might have to donate. The money raised for that will be going to help fund the international conference in Uganda in October. The dates for the sale are September 16th and 17th. There will be more information coming out shortly. I know they'll start posting it on Facebook and things like that. So Fonda was just saying, let's just start getting the word out so people can start praying over their donations and what they'd like to do. The point of the sale is to have a treasure that you want to donate for it and to write a little story about that treasure. And it could be something that's valuable as far as monetarily, or it could be something that's valuable to you personally. And so there'll be more information and things like that coming out for that. But that's kind of what we've got going on.
Okay.
I think we're good with that.
Great. Well, thank you guys so much for sticking with us. I want to open us in prayer. Lord, I just thank you so much for all these dedicated people, Lord. We work so hard to get closer to you so that we can share your love with the people around us, Father. We just pray that you open our hearts and our minds this evening. Give me wisdom in the things that I've been studying and the things that you want me to share tonight. And I just pray that, Lord, you'll just be in our midst. Lord, we thank you for our minds and how you've made them so intricate and so amazing. And Lord, we just pray that you help us to have wisdom to help unlock some of these people's that we're working with problems, Father, and their life stories to help them come draw them closer to you so that they see that the treasure really is them, Father. We thank you for that. Just bless our evening in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Guys, again, this is new to say the least. I just found out, I think it was on Monday, that I was going to be here the whole entire 2.5 hours. So we might be getting out early. So hopefully
what do they call that? A gift of time?
But feel free to kind of hang on to your question, or even as we go, just kind of say a little something if you have a question as we go. This is a topic, Cindy wanted me to pick something that I was interested in but didn't know anything about. So this is kind of what I came up with. And it's I've been a teacher for decades now. I taught K-5. As well as being a foster mom for 16 years and doing just involved with kids a lot, but also with adults. And the more I learned from Cindy, the more I realized a lot of our adult problems stem from our childhood issues. So art therapy is just a great way to tap into that childlike self and be able to express things that maybe we aren't able to express just using words. So let's kind of move along here. Oh, there we go. So this is just kind of what we're going to talk about. So art therapy has been around for quite some time, since the mid-20s. And it started in Europe, in England, with a British artist named Adrian Hill. And he, in 1942, kind of was the person who coined art therapy. It was back when they were having problems in the sanitariums from tuberculosis. I have a little video from Australia that talks more about it coming from Europe when and American and everywhere after the wars and finding it as an outlet for the wars. So there's a little bit of conflict of who started it and what came from where. But so it quickly spread to mental hospitals through the work of Edward Adamson, who observed and further studied the connection between artistic expression and emotional release. The British Association of Art Therapists founded in 1967. And then that was by the educator Margaret Nonberg and artist Edith Kramer. And you can find quite a bit about them. And then the American Art Therapy Association was founded in 1969. So I wanted to show this little clip. I'm hoping it'll work. We'll see. I was not able to. My husband was so good about naming things. So let's see if it comes up. Unfortunately, it's like you never know what the advertising is going to be. Is this going to, do I have to turn my volume up?
I don't know. And if you do, we may get feedback, but let's see.
Okay. See if I can get rid of the ad. Why is it not? I want to build a website. We have to get rid of my people here. Oh, there we go. Oh, all right. Maybe I can just fast forward.
So do you have it playing on your screen right now?
I do.
Okay.
And it's not coming
Because screen. I think you need to share screen again. So okay. Do you stop sharing?
Stop. Stop share. Okay. Uh-huh. And then
do start sharing again. And then choose your video. Remember how you chose the PowerPoint last time?
Yeah.
Instead, this time choose the YouTube.
Is it going? Oh, no, that's back.
Okay, so going to start. Okay, so going to Zoom.
Up here. And you're meeting her. Right here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What do I need to end this video?
Do stop video or, yeah.
You need to stop.
Or stop share. Hold on. Go in here. Go to.
Oh, no, I'm not.
Wait, where's Zoom? Zoom. Because this is YouTube. Oh, here. Oh, is that you?
I think.
No, that's me. Okay, so where are you on here?
I think it just went away.
Go this way.
Oh,
that's go again. One more time. One more.
Oh, what happened to us?
Hmm.
Oh, no. Let's see. Maybe we have to stop sharing. Maybe that.
Oh, okay. There we go.
There we are.
Okay. Now go share screen. Now click your YouTube video. Do you see it here? Is it there?
Oh. Yes.
Okay. Now push play. Okay. You're going to, yeah, turn your volume up. Let's see.
That gives you a way to express yourself.
Can you guys hear?
Yes.
Perfect.
Okay, this is a short little video that talks about where it came from.
My name is Chris Bielton, and I'm an art therapist. Art therapy uses a variety of art materials that gives you a way to express yourself, not just through words, but through art making. Art therapy is more about the process than the quality of the end product, so it doesn't need to be aesthetically beautiful. It's more about what you get out of it and the meaning you make of the art in the session.
Art, as you know, is a non-verbal process. People have been using it for centuries. The rituals of creating a piece of art embodies the person themselves, the direct result of what that person in therapy is experiencing is projected onto the paper. Once they've created an image, as an art therapist, we ask the client to talk about what they've created, if they can. If they don't talk about it, the therapy still works because it's such a deep unconscious process.
So one of the great things about art and using it therapeutically is that it can be done at home as well. You can use a journal to record how you're feeling, thinking via art. It's a great self-help tool.
Art therapy began being used in health settings after two devastating world wars in the 20th century. This resulted in many soldiers and civilians having difficulties readjusting to life in peacetime. New approaches to treating mental illness, including art therapy and group therapy, were developed in the UK and USA in increasingly overstretched mental health facilities used to treat returning soldiers with post-traumatic stress disorder. This then began to expand to other areas of mental health.
A variety of age ranges really can attend art therapy. It can be from a very young age right through to the elderly, and any, you know, they may have a mental health issue. There may just be someone who's struggling with an issue at the moment who wants to understand themselves better and understand why things have happened to them in the past or in the present. It offers often young people, especially who don't have the cognitive capacity to necessarily talk about what they're doing, to find a way to express themselves through art.
So art therapy can be a bit of a hook into having that young person open up and feel more comfortable and relaxed. And it also allows them to express themselves in a narrative that's very different to the traditional medical interview around mental health. It allows them to integrate their story in a way that has more humanity to it.
Someone who's an adult and hasn't used art materials for a long time, you might start really simply with them and even using collage, so actually using magazine images, things that they can tear, so showing them that it doesn't have to be perfect, they don't just have to cut it out, and then, you know, they can explore lots of different material.
We've used pastels, we've had paints, we've had clay, paper mache, we've made puppets, we've had young people sew objects that are precious to them. Yes, we've had so many different artistic expressions going on in that space.
So it is therapy and not just art making. We actually have a triangular relationship where there is the relationship between the therapist and the client, but also the art material. And at certain points, there can be more emphasis on the art. There can be more emphasis on the relationship. It can go in different directions. Ultimately, we want people to build an understanding of themselves, to work through difficult experiences in their life, to gain insight, and hopefully repair some of the ruptures from either their current lives or their past experience.
Art therapy is an important field of study in the Masters of Mental Health. It's a particularly interesting field of study because it relies on non-verbal, expressive ways of accessing processes that assist people to resolve and deal with their problems.
I'm going to stop this here. Then how do I get back to the Zoom? Over here. Do I go back to my Zoom link?
Yep. You go, nope, you go here. And then you're going to do new share because you want to go back to the PowerPoint, right?
Yep.
And then go back to your PowerPoint. And then go share down there.
Okay, thank you.
Now turn off your sound for now until you need it again.
Okay, thank you guys so much for bearing with me. I practiced this at home, but I did not have technical difficulties like this. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Not if you can hear me?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yes.
So art therapy is a form of psychotherapy involving encouragement of free self-expression through painting, drawing, or modeling, using as a remedial activity or an aid to diagnosis. So the good thing that you guys will be happy to hear is that as a therapist, you don't necessarily need to do the art with them. So if you hear the topic art therapy and think, oh my goodness, there's no way I'd ever do this, I want you to rethink that a little bit, because I think you're going to find that you have clients that are not, you know, Cindy says, oh, you got your self-starters and then just take off and you just can't write fast enough. And then you've got other people you just really have to draw out, especially people who have had trauma when they're young, which actually ends up being quite a few of our clients. So it's just a really great way to have them be doing something while you are talking with them. As you saw, some of these people were doing it side by side. Some of them were doing it while they were talking. And then some, as you'll see in the next video, are doing it as a activity to delve into their thoughts. The next video that I want to share is probably more what you think of how art therapy is used. And then I'm going to give you some great ideas that you can use just with your own children, if you're doing family therapy, if you're doing a group of people, just to kind of get them to connect and just to go a little deeper. So it's been widely studied, and observed how art therapy is effective to treat trauma, abuse, grief, anxiety, eating disorders, alleviate stress and pain and suffering. And I would say that most of our clients would fit under these issues. And so it's really a multi-purpose tool that you can use across the board with all ages of your clients. You can do the same project with all of them, or you could just do it with someone that you're having a hard time reaching. So I think you're gonna find this kind of interesting. But how does it work? Well, it works to bring the conscious, unconscious, and subconscious into expressive and tangible forms. The creative processes in art therapy have been praised for their ability to encourage personal growth, mindfulness, and self-discovery. So it goes down into the, because when you're working on art, you tap into that other, that more creative part of your brain. So this is my next. So
so you're going to go share a nail up at the top.
Okay.
And we'll pull up on here. Yep.
For the top one. Desktop or Google Chrome? No.
Probably Google Chrome, because that's where it's pulling you to, I bet. Okay. Then you should be able to push play.
I'm going to preface this video, can you guys put the video in here, with the gal's problem, because it's a rather long video. So I wanted to preface it with, she's been moving around a lot all of her life. Her family was in the military growing up. She moved from place to place, loved the adventure, really never had problems settling into the next place. Then they pick up and move again. Then as an adult, she found that she was doing the same thing. But this move, the most recent one, she's having a terrible time connecting with people, feeling settled. She just hates it. And she's so frustrated and doesn't know how to get past this and start making friends, because she's just so in her head about everything. So rather than explaining all this to you, I thought we would just kind of fast forward to the part where they start the actual therapy part, because I think it's kind of, you'll find it interesting. Okay. You able to hear it?
You have to unmute your volume again.
Yeah.
So
she's gonna.
Can you hear on Zoom?
They can't. If someone just kind of fast, they kind of just do this whole thing. She colors for quite a while. This is what she ends up drawing. Give you a minute to look at that. So she's drawing her last place.
So she told her to give her.
So now she's drawing a picture of what her current situation looks like. This is her picture that she drew in her current situation. Okay, that's that one. So that's kind of what I was thinking I would see when I was looking for for art therapy. I was kind of thinking, oh, people draw pictures, they'll talk about them, some of them will be abstract, and you'll go really deep, and you'll, this symbolizes this, and this symbolizes this. It really wasn't quite like that, as I recall. How do I get back to my PowerPoint?
Go into start, share new or start, or,
okay.
And then pick your PowerPoint.
Okay.
Not the one, not on the Google.
Okay, yeah.
There you go. Yep.
Okay. So that was kind of what I was thinking I would be looking at, but as I studied it more, I found it was more a combination of different things. It's using just tools to get people to open up and talk. It's getting them to use their hands. It's getting them to use color and be mindful of where they're at. You can use it as an introduction kind of a thing to kind of calm people down if they're coming in really flustered and stressed. So that was what I found was very interesting with this art therapy. So we're going to try a little lesson today. And you're going to have to scrounge around in your house really quick, I'm afraid, because so you'll need to have I tried to find something that most people would have something of. So if you have a piece of paper, I would suggest just a piece of white paper is great. Like computer paper is great. Notebook, whatever you're taking notes on is fine. And then a pencil, and then if you are a crayon or pencil or a pen would be fine. And then if you have like colored pencils or anything like that, that would be fine too. Don't stress if you don't have any of that handy. You can always go back and do it later. And then the last thing is a picture of yourself or a mirror. Oh. And the great thing is for you that are online, you've got yourself on your computer. So you could pin yourself and use that. I put on the screen is the picture that I took of myself. I just took a picture with my phone, which was super quick and easy. And the nice thing about that is then it's stable because we're actually going to draw kind of our head. And if you're looking, kind of glancing down and drawing, it's going to be a little more challenging to do. So if you just took a quick picture of your head, and as you can see, I didn't have much makeup on. It was just really quick the other day. I decided that's who I am. So that's what I decided. So paper, pencil, and colored pencils, or don't worry too much about the color at this point. And then a picture of yourself or a mirror. Or if you just have a picture of yourself handy, that would be fine too. So
let me take a selfie.
Yeah, so you just manually your head. You don't have to have your whole body. We're just going to do the head today. So is everybody have something or ready pretty much? Okay. Well, we'll scooch along. If you're getting behind, you can catch up. We'll just kind of see how this goes. So before we get started with the actual art part, we're going to kind of do like a mindfulness part of it. Cindy talks so much about, you know, getting the clients grounded, and you know, this is great art therapy. This type of art therapy would be great for people who have self-image problems, or you know, dyslexia, or people who've had big trauma when they were younger. Because sometimes I think people forget to see what they really look like. So look closely at your face and notice these things. Notice your eyes. Notice the color, all the different colors, not usually just one. Notice the shape of them. Notice your eyelashes. Notice the sparkle in your eye. Notice how your eyes might be unique to other than other people's. How are your eyebrows arranged above your eyes? The color, the thickness. I was noticing mine are getting a little gray. Gotta stay positive with this though. How's your nose shaped? Depth, color, markings. It's interesting because noses, when you start looking at them, are so unusual. Your shape and your color of your lips, your teeth, your chin. How your hair frames your face, and if you can see your ears. Notice other additions. Are you wearing glasses? Do you have freckles? Do you have dimples or other marks? Are you wearing earrings or have other piercings? Do you have facial hair? So that kind of helps you get grounded to kind of get used to looking at your face for what it is. Mm-hmm. It's interesting because I don't know about you guys, but with COVID, I found I didn't really look at myself very much because I'm skipping over here, skipping over there, and I really wasn't getting dressed up with makeup and all. And it was interesting doing this. I noticed so many things just of how I've aged in the recent years. So it's kind of an interesting thing to notice. And I wasn't sad about that, which is a very good thing. So here's our, this is what our lesson is going to be. And I kind of put just part of my drawing here so you can see we're not looking for perfection. They're gonna look kind of weird, and that's the point of it. We're not trying to make it look just exactly like ourselves, but you're kind of wanting to get the gist of who you are. So it says, without picking up your pencil, draw your head and face using one continuous line. Include your eyes, your eyebrows, your nose, your lips, hair, etc. It's okay to retrace some lines to finish the shape. Add other features to make it look like you. So don't like pick up your pencil and just start drawing your eyebrows. It's kind of just a whole big thing. This next slide kind of, I guess I colored it in already. But this is kind of my rig. Let's see, can you see this? Up close, let's see. There we go. So that's my initial part. And then I went through, where's my camera? This is the camera over here. That's why you're not seeing it. Okay. So this is my initial one. I'm like, oh, there's something weird over here about my hair. So I kind of filled in more hair. You're going to just pick a corner. I chose to start like up here where my part was. And I kind of went around, then did the hair, and then kind of came back. And so the trick is to not pick up your pencil. And that's kind of what makes it look, has it kind of gives it like a impressionist kind of a look. So you're kind of getting away from that perfectionism that some artists might do where it's everything is all perfect. So just kind of take one continuous line and draw your entire face. And it's funny because I grew up in a family of artists, and I never really considered myself an artist, but this kind of was, it took away some of my hesitations because it wasn't supposed to be perfect. You're just kind of looking that it's the gist of you. I'll give you a few minutes to do that. This is a really good one when you have somebody that's been through trauma or post-traumatic type of things, because sometimes I think people forget to see themselves in it. So they're kind of looking at some of the details of themselves and who they are on the outside. And of course, you're going to be delving inside. In a few minutes, we're going to be talking about some of our core values and some of the things that are your gifts and talents. And what was the other thing? Gifts, talents, and or just things that you're good at, people that are important to you, your identity with people. So you can kind of be thinking about some of those things. We're going to write them around the outside in a little while.
Do I have to do the whole thing?
Yeah. Yeah, they get a little silly. And it's like, I kind of laughed when I was doing mine too, because it's kind of like, oh, this is kind of funny. It's a little bizarre. I realized later when I was looking at mine or coloring it in, I was like, oh, I actually didn't draw eyebrows. I just kind of have my eyelids are the eyebrows. That's okay. Mm-hmm. You're going to be your own critic, so don't worry. And it's not even that you're going to be critical. This is all about being positive.
Yeah, I'm trying to
notice your positive traits.
Totally changed. Jean's strategy is for one more eyeballs.
I like to see those also, though. That worked. Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
I didn't even get to my glasses. And I moved up my pen.
Oh, well, you can put it down somewhere else.
Yeah, but I gave myself a mustache.
That's fun. So Veronica is showing you hers. Very fun. Does anybody else want to share theirs? It's like some of you have kind of found a place where you're finishing up. Does anybody else want to share what they've had so far?
Here.
Oh, Deanna's going to share hers. Oh, that's great.
Wow, that is good.
It's just
how do I?
That's cute. I like how you did your hair. Oh, it's actually up on this camera over there, is where she did it.
Yep, you can do it right here. Let me see Deanna again.
Oh yeah.
Oh, she did
good.
That's good
with the glasses too.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
All right, let's see yours, Colin.
Okay. There's me.
Yeah, you did good too. Yeah.
I like your blue.
It is funny because even without all the features, you can still tell it's you.
Really?
I think so, yeah. Anybody else want to share? You don't have to, but you're welcome to if you'd like to. Don't want to leave anybody out. Okay, well, we're gonna kind of move on to the next thing. Feel free to keep doing this if you're still at that point. So this is something in therapy that you could just do this first part, just as a beginning kind of a thing when you're first getting to know somebody. You could do it as a group if you were doing a group thing, a group activity. You could even put them in a pile and see if people can guess who they are, just for funsies.
Did you say we should wait to hold our questions or go ahead and ask?
Oh, no, if you have questions, go ahead and ask during. Yeah.
Okay, so I'm wondering if there's like, because maybe I'm just not like an artist or something, but I like, is there a point or is there a thing that we're supposed to get to?
As we go on.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay, thanks.
So this is kind of an impressionist style of drawing, and it's actually an art form, but it's the idea is that you're looking just from a few lines and shapes, you're making your outline of your face. And I love seeing the few that I saw because it really does, you did a great job of pointing out the things that you were doing. Let's see if I can move to the next one. So the next one is we're gonna color each individual shape a different color. Do not use two colors next to each other. If you only have a pencil, you could just do shading and do it like darker and lighter, black and gray. Unfortunately, in my drawing, you can't really tell. The cheeks were actually pink, but I'll put this up here so you can kind of see. This was my original drawing that I did when I colored it.
Here we go. So it's kind of pink. So it looks really weird, but it also kind of just brings out different features. So you're kind of making things distorted is the goal of this part.
So I'll give you a few minutes to do that. So you'll have some sections that are very big and you'll have other sections that are very small. So, and that's just fine. Something that you can do.
This is fun. I haven't colored in years.
I know. I was kind of thinking, she was saying that she hasn't colored in years. And it is kind of a, you forget how much you enjoy something like that.
Yeah.
I was thinking after doing this, maybe I should get one of those adult coloring books. That might be kind of fun.
My daughter has an adult coloring book that is the sarcastic adult coloring book.
Can you guys hear her? She was, Veronica was saying that her daughter has an adult coloring book that's very sarcastic. So it's just kind of funny.
I'm not playing today.
You can hang up.
Go ask my mom. I'm not an adult.
Yeah,
different little things like that. And she'll do it for hours.
So while you're coloring, yeah. I want you to think about the things that you value. What are your values? What are the things, what are your talents that God has given you? What are your gifts? And what are your strengths? And then lastly, who are you like to different people? That would be another thing. Like sister, brother, son, daughter. While you're going, you can think about that.
And should we write that on here?
Not yet, we can think about it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now while you're with the client, and they're coloring, are you asking them questions as they're coloring?
Yeah, or
are you
just... I mean, whatever it is that they're going through, you're talking about, well, what, you know, what, depending on the age, what have you been doing at school? What have you been doing at work? Which connections have you had during work? You can ask all of these questions about whatever it is that they came for therapy on. You can talk about those things while you're coloring with them, because they can... People tend to open up more because they're opening and sharing things that are on their heart,
so,
and not really being purposeful about it. So
how do you start? Like, somebody comes in your office,
mm-hmm.
and say, you just hand them some stuff and say, okay, start drawing this, and we'll talk about what you want to talk about, but I want you to start drawing this.
Yeah, so you talk about, you start them out, and then it's kind of, sometimes that's kind of a nice segue into, because the things that you talk about in therapy can be so deep,
yeah.
And this will give them a nice day. And when things are getting a little heavy, like let's say you're talking about their spouse's relationship with them, and they're coloring, and they're telling you that the way they talk to him, the tone is just so disrespectful, and they try to tell him it's not respectful or something like that, and they're getting like agitated. You can say, yeah, I hear what you're saying. What color are you going to put next? You know, kind of just get them, it kind of grounds them back to, oh, I'm up here in my head, and oh yeah, I'm coloring over here. So
okay.
It kind of helps you bring them back around to ground them. They're using fine motor skills, they're smelling the crayons or pencils and things like that. So there's a lot of things there that are kind of used as grounding, and that's kind of part of the magic, I guess I would say, of art therapy is, it kind of, I don't want to say it tricks people into opening up, but they can open up a lot deeper, and it works a little faster because they're busy doing something else while they're talking about it.
Now, would you say to a client, like, you do art therapy, would you like to do some coloring, or is it just like, depends on how they come in that day for their session?
You can use it as you could be an art therapist and you're the only one that does that all the time, you know,
yeah.
Kind of a thing. Or you could be the type of person that, you know, I feel so awkward with this person. You'll have people that you know, they come in, they're all amped up. You got to be able to kind of calm them down, or they're just so quiet that they come in and you're like, okay, 15 minutes. What are we going to talk about for the next half hour? You know, so this kind of a activity would get them to kind of open up. And sometimes quiet's okay. They say that with art therapy. For some people, it's fine to just have a little moment where they're coloring if they're not feeling like talking. And then you can kind of just say, oh, I noticed you use a lot of blues. Do you like blues? What kind of things do you like to better blue? Or, you know, those kind of things. Or get it into more of a personal level, you can, you know, even talk about, I guess it all kind of depends on what their issues are. I've had like people who have had troubles keeping jobs, and you kind of figure out pretty quickly that their attention span is very short. And so, you know, trying to draw that out, and, you know, how do you stretch yourself when you find yourself disinterested in something? And you, like, for something like this, it does take a little bit of focus to be able to keep coloring and keep finding different colors. But you can, you know, kind of look at this. You focused on this for 10 minutes and you did such a great job. So maybe when you're working, what could you do to help you focus and extend your interest longer in work? So, I mean, there's all kinds of, every client, I have 5 clients right now, and every client is so incredibly different. They're all women, you know, probably a 10-year age span of difference, but that's not so much. It's just crazy how different they are, but they all open up about, you know, things that are going on in their lives, and you just want to be as helpful to them as you can, and to, you know, bring them to Jesus through the whole process, so that they have someone to rely on. Because I have some that are Christians and some that are not. So I'm gonna, since we're kind of, we're gonna move along here, I'm gonna we'll do the last part. And unfortunately, in my photograph, you can't see my words very well, so I did it as a frame. So we're gonna talk about, write positive words that describe you, your values, talents, accomplishments, roles, identities, and strengths around the frame. So here's mine. It just kind of makes a frame. And this is something that, as you could even keep this in your client's folder and have them keep adding things. When you find that they have a talent or something that you didn't know, you can say, oh, hey, let's add that to your portrait. And you can kind of keep adding things as time goes on. For example, I'm a Jesus girl. I'm a wife. I've got 8 kids. I've got friends. I'm a friend to people. I've got a couple sisters. But I'm also teaching is important to me. Teaching people to read, and I love to read. Helpful. I try to see people. Forgiveness is really important. Connecting with people, connecting through events and activities, music, worship. Those are the kind of things that Jesus, joy, organizing. Just random things that came to mind as I was coloring and stuff. So that's kind of what I personally did. So you just write those around the outside. And like I said, you know, it's not like as soon as the person walks away, you're going to think of like 4 or 5 more. Because I know that's what I did after making my list. I'm like, oh, I can add this to the list. And you kind of have, because you have different facets of yourself. You think of yourself at home. You think of yourself at work. You think of yourself when you're in the community or at church or with your extended family. So they see all kinds of different things. And sometimes it's kind of interesting to even say, well, what would your spouse say about you? What would they say that your strengths are? What would your pastor say are your strengths? What would your doctor say your strengths? I don't know, maybe not your doctor. So that would be something. What would your children say about your strengths? What would your neighbors say about your strengths? So it's kind of like there's all kinds of different facets of life. And not that we're perfect in any of them, but there's things that, you know, that people notice about us, because that's what God created us to be. Everybody's a little different, and there's things that people notice that they like to see. So has anybody written some things down that stood out? Did anybody want to share some of the words that they wrote down that they thought of when they thought of some of their strengths or their some positive values about yourself?
It's so much fun. I never draw myself, and it's my first time to draw myself. I don't know, can you see?
I love it. I Fancy it. It's wonderful. Looks just like you. Yeah, that's great. Yeah. It, you know, sometimes it makes you realize too, especially, you know, when you're a mom or you've got, you know, you're so busy just doing life that you need to stop and take time for yourself too. So I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Really not good with drawing, but it's so much fun for me to draw myself.
Yeah, well, if anybody, that's the person you know the most, I hope.
And I write down some sentence, but I'm not sure that. I just wanted to share the picture.
Yeah, that's really nice. I love it. And you know what I love is that you said that you didn't think you were good at drawing, and yet you're art is wonderful, but it's also, I love that you still did it anyway. And I think that that's the way it is with clients, that it's not, when they know that they're not going to be judged on something and they know it's just for fun, then
yeah,
you kind of open up and enjoy it. And it's like amazing how you feel like, wow, I'm actually kind of in the experience. That's kind of what why I wanted you guys to try it, because like I said, oftentimes as the counselor, you wouldn't necessarily be doing this yourself. You'd be doing, you know, kind of directing somebody else through it. And you can see how healing and grounding it is and how you're kind of focusing, but you can still listen and participate at the same time. So thank you. Thank you for sharing.
Art therapy is really new for me, and I never heard it before. And actually, for myself, I'm really not good with drawing. And I think I would like to do this in my home with my children and my husband. We're gonna do this.
Oh, good. Yeah,
yes.
Well, I'm giving a lot more ideas that are not just drawing too, because art therapy has a lot of extended things as well. So I think that you're gonna have fun with this next part that we do.
A good comment, but
yeah,
I was writing positive words, and okay, it really helps because I'm lacking in confidence a lot.
Okay. Can you guys hear her?
So just in general, in life, I seem to lack confidence, and I'm hearing that from a lot of people. And I, as I think about it, it's very true. But doing this exercise, having to write positive words, I really found quite a few positive things, and it's a bit of a confidence booster.
Yeah. Okay. Make sure you write on there that you like to share what you have. She brought snacks and keeps offering to share.
Oh.
You like to share.
Yeah. Okay. Like,
I love that. Is there anybody else that wanted to share something?
I started to make a list like that. I'm a lover of Jesus, a lover of people, a lover of animals, a lover of plants. And then I found myself writing a lover of my barn.
You know what, though? If that's your happy place, that's great.
I thought, oh, yeah, I love my barn.
That's really sweet. Yeah, that's great. Okay, well, we're going to move on here. So you can even go like deeper on it. What did you learn about yourself? I love how Deanna had said that she loved her barn, and that's probably something she already knew, but it's kind of neat that she put it up there with her top things. So what did you learn about yourself? Who are you? I think the nice thing about when you start writing positive things about yourself, you realize that you're not your mistakes. You're not your list of grievances that people have against you. You wrote the things that are positive, the way that God sees us, the way God created us. And that's why I encourage people to make the list, continue adding things to the list, so you can pull it out when you're having a tough day or a tough self-image day, or you're just not feeling very positive. You can pull it out and realize, hey, I am a good person. I do have value, and I can contribute to these kind of things. So another way you could do it is, another twist would be, are you the same person you were 10 years ago? Sometimes when you're working with adults, they feel so stuck that when they look at themselves, they forget, actually, I've come a long way. I've grown a lot. I've matured and made better decisions in the last few years than maybe I have in the past. So sometimes it's a good reflection as to where they were and where, how far they've come. Or maybe even what they were brought up with and then what they offer now. Because sometimes when kids have been in a really challenging upbringing and home life, it's amazing that people turn out as good as they do. Last thing was notice how you've changed and what is better about you. So I'm just kind of focusing on that positive. This is the part that I really got into, that because I thought this was the art therapy, was just the whole drawing thing, but there's so much more to it. And I love it because most of it is stuff that's free that you can do. This could be with your family. It could be with a family group. It could be with a group of, if you do a Bible study, if you have a prayer group, it could be like if you're even doing like things like anger management or a teen group or a youth group, or with individuals that are clients as well. So so there's all kinds of ideas here, and I'm gonna, for some of my friends here that are English as a second language, feel free to stop me if you need more exclamation about things. I tried to write some of them down so you could spell them out if you needed to look them up. But I just had that thought today. I'm like, rats, I wish I had more time to put this together because I would have put pictures of all the different types of activities that you could do. But I wasn't sure how much time I would have and how much, you know, I would talk about it. So I might have to skip through some of them. But there's a great YouTube out there that I kind of looked at that had a lot of ideas, and I added some of my own as well. So a collage is where you have like a whole bunch of pictures put together, and you can do a collage of things that make you happy. You could do a collage of your barn. You could do a collage with all the things about the barn that you like, the maybe the tackle and the bridal gear and the earthy kind of smell that you think of with a barn or wood. And you can make a big collage out of that. And the great thing about technology these days is you can make all these, you could find these pictures on the internet that your clients could, and then they could put them together just with pictures from the internet. So they wouldn't have to go digging through magazines and whatnot, like we might have when we were a child, or they could put them together with magazines, but it doesn't always have to be photographs or pictures either. It could be pieces from a, it could be on a picture, it could be on a bulletin board, it could be on a book or a notebook cover. It could be on the outside of a scrapbook, and you could put like different like themes. You could have things that you want to do for yourself, things that you want to do on a vacation, things that you want to do when you have some time off, books you want to read, like have a different page for each if you're doing like a scrapbook. You could do like a photo blanket, which I thought was a great idea. Some people, like my sister-in-law, she's a quilter and she's made lots of blankets with like her kids' t-shirts. Like one of her kids likes to go to concerts, and so they cut out all the tops of the t-shirts that they gotten over the years, and she made a big quilt out of them just because it kind of is a fun memory. Or jeans, you could do it with clothing, or just anything that reminds you of your reminds you of something, like especially for like if you were a survivor of a crime, you could do something for like an escape, you know, something like a happy place or a place where you feel safe. They even talked about doing like collages in Minecraft, the Minecraft game that's on the kids play. Can be an escape place that you share. So these activities that I'm suggesting are things that you could do with your client in the office or your family or your group, or you could even have them do it as a ongoing assignment. One of the hard things that Cindy talks about a lot is, you know, making sure you have an assignment for your clients so that when they're outside of the office, then they will have an opportunity to still be thinking about the things that you talked about. So for the different things that you could put in your collage, you put buttons, yarn, t-shirts, objects that represent things, dried leaves, flowers, nature, printed coloring pictures, food boxes and bags. You know, sometimes they have all these cute little critters on things, or like on cat food or something. Paint, finger paint, markers, stamps, macaroni, have some texture. But it's one of those things that a collage is just sticking a whole bunch of stuff on a paper or a poster board and just kind of having an idea of like a theme to it or something. Let's see. I think that's probably a good one to stop with. Sculptures, you could use like clay, Play-Doh, or salt dough that can dry, which is good. There's lots of recipes and cookbooks where you can just go online to get a recipe for dough that's made out of salt and it dries hard, so you can keep it forever, and you can even paint it. But you could do, what would you do with a sculpture? You could do, like a sculpture of what you want to be, where you're hurting. You could do it, where you're hurting now and what you'd like it to look like, before and after recovery, what you looked like, a positive memory, like a garden or something like that. You could have them sculpt emotions, which is a really kind of a fun thing. People really get creative when you have something abstract and you're supposed to sculpt something like anger or grief or joy. How would you sculpt that? And, you know, they're just saying they're squishing the dough in their hands and making it, you know, everybody would do something different with it. If you guys were all in the class, I would have brought you like Play-Doh and some of these things to play with so that you could kind of see, you know, make little snakes with it and make a little pot or something. But so lots of things you can do with sculpturing. Puppets, they have lots of ideas with puppets. Puppets for a therapist actually can be really good because you can talk about things that maybe the person wouldn't want to talk about. And you think of puppets only for kids, but they're actually great for adults too. It's a great way to role play with clients. Like, let's pretend like this is your spouse and this is you. Show me what it looks like when you're talking to him. Show me what it looks like when he's talking to you. And what would you like to see? What would be a more healthy approach to that question or that situation? So you can role play and get people comfortable with that. So if you're making puppets, you can make puppets out of pretty much anything. Those puppets are the little things you like, you talk to each other and stuff. So you could do them out of socks. You could do them out of, especially because we all have socks that get lost in the dryer or whatnot. Yeah. And you can make them very simple. You can be silly with a puppet. So that, you know, when you're getting tense or something, you could say, I don't like that the way you're talking, or, you know, something like that, so that the person could kind of calm and kind of put a smile on their face. You could kind of even do like a Punch and Judy, kind of like the old English kind of play, kind of being silly about it. You can have families demonstrate their dynamics or practice talking kindly to each other. Other things to make other than just using socks, you can staple or glue or sew felt together, fabric. You can do popsicle puppets with the old popsicle sticks or a hair ribbon, brown paper bags. They don't last very well, so if you're going to use it several, you would have to probably keep it in their file or something. And like paper towel rolls or things like that, lots of different things. And you can really great for people who have a hard time talking for themselves, people who've had post-traumatic stress syndrome from big events like wars and things like that, it's sometimes easier to talk to the puppet maybe than it is to the therapist, or to maybe have the puppet talk to the therapist. So there's different ways that you can kind of get around that with it being kind of sweet and fun, but then you could also make it so that it goes really deep. When the topic's too emotionally charged, puppets can be amazing. So another idea is to do like angel and a devil for decision-making. What would be the good things that would happen? What would be the bad? What are the choices that would be poorer for that? You can teach personal skills like empathy. What is his face looking like? How do you think he's feeling? How would you react to somebody that has tears coming down their eyes or something like that? So also you can act out a challenge, something that the family's dealing with or the client is dealing with how, what's one way you can do it, what's another way you can do it. And then another idea is for somebody that has attachment issues or that is struggling to keep themselves grounded, if you make a smaller puppet, they can keep it in their wallet or in their pocket and they can feel it and they can think, oh, that's my little angel. What am I going to think? What is a good choice for this situation if they're struggling with making good choices or not? Especially if they're feeling anxious or not safe about situations. You know, I'm going to hold my little angel puppet and I'm going to try and take 5 steps out of my house today, or that kind of a thing, to just kind of be that little token for them to help keep, feel like they're keeping safe. Another idea is a gratitude tree. And that would just be as simple as having like a tree and you clip things onto it. I noticed in Good Samaritan over here in the corner, we have one that has like different people all over the world hung on the tree that maybe people are praying for or something. And so there's all kinds of different things you can put on the tree, different themes for the tree, but you can make it out of a real tree. This one happens to be a silk tree that's over here with little gift tags hanging on it. But you could do sticks and put tags on it. You could use sticky notes and just put them on a wall. You could do, you could have cutouts for leaves with different things. You could have, you could even put other things on the tree like squirrels and fruits and birds and things for monumental things. You can sometimes, for homework, you could do something if the person's really struggling with positivity and they just can't find the good in the day, is to, you know, have them put a sticky note on their mirror, you know, kind of frame the mirror and tell them you can't see yourself anymore with something good that they're going to try to do that day, or something that they're thankful for, or somebody or something that they're thankful for. I think especially when you're dealing with grief, it's so hard to get out of that grief. And in order to get out of the grief, you have to get out of yourself. And when you start thinking of the things that you are thankful for and so much that has been given to you, it's a great way to start being appreciative of the person you've lost, the traits that they've given you, and those kind of things, and the activities that you might have shared together. So that's some of the things. There's lots of things you could do with the gratitude tree. Wind chimes would be another idea, where you put keys or buttons and hang them and you hang it outside and then the wind kind of makes it clink together. You could use just any kind of old stuff. You could do soda bottles. You don't even have to have it be noisy. You could do things that are shiny, or you could do things that spin or things like that. But this is a great way to address grief. You could have things that the person lost to help them remember the person, kind of as a tribute to them, things from grandma or a situation. Maybe it was baking spoons and recipes or something. Some of your favorite things like shells or cookie cutters or happy memories or stained glass. Oh, another idea was stained glass. You could do something. Oh, sorry, that was my next one, stained glass. Sorry, I'm moving along apparently. Stained glass. I'm like, why would you put stained glass for a wind chime? That seems like a very bad idea. So please do not. okay, anyway, so they were saying for stained glass, you could do things like they have like sheets of shrinking inks, and or you could even just color clear plastic and cut it out. But this is great for mindfulness, to keep people's focus. When people are stressed or are in the midst of trauma or anxiety, they need things that are going to ground them, that are going to keep their attention, that they're going to that they can notice and be like, oh, that is beautiful, that is nice, or something like that. So they talked about doing like a sun catcher that you could hang in your window, or doing a memory window with different positive memories. Like when you were in track, you could have that, and you could have a thing with your, like when you had your first horse, and you have all these different positive memories that you might have had throughout your life. When you're in a place that it doesn't seem like much good is happening, those are the kind of things that help you keep your focus. or you could string things along and clip them on like garland and put things in front of the lights, like you do like twinkle lights or something, and stick stuff in them. Things that make you happy, like flowers or furry critters. Could do things that remind me of someone that you lost, or stained glass ornaments. You could make them and put them on a tree kind of idea, or even do it for the holidays. Things that you want to do or have, like a dream kind of a thing, things that you want to do in your future. Maybe you want to graduate, or you want to have a family, or you know, have this like kind of like a future-ish thick kind of exciting thing. Any questions so far? Not yet. Okay. So lots of fun things that you can do.
Lori?
Yes.
I just wanted to say this is an interesting class, and this is one of the first times that I've actually taken time to draw something that looks, that might look like myself.
I love that.
I'm too concrete.
Right.
But I want to say that what you said is really true, because my wife is a mosaic artist, and she has a shop where lots of women, and mostly women, come in, and they do collages and things like this. I can't go to the shop. Her shop is dark outside now here, but I can show some of the things around the house here, which reflect what you're showing. See, like this one. Can you see this one?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. So this is cloth. They put things like that together, and then they frame them.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's beautiful.
And then this one, they do a boutique like this.
Oh, wow. That's lovely.
And this one, I can't interpret some of them, but this is like a tree or something. It's got birds on top and roots and rocks. So this is made of, they have pieces of tile that are cut together and then put in strips like this.
That's a great idea. That is so beautiful.
And then this one, you see, again, pieces of tile, just put together and then into a bird with a bird in it.
Wow.
Just saying something. It, like this one has sing. It has just ideas that somebody is telling about themselves. So it's a key off. Just whatever comes to your mind at that time.
Yeah.
This says something about somebody, about what the person.
Can you down a little bit, Joe? We're just seeing the corner. There we go.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, that's awesome.
It's beautiful. Oh, I like that. Okay.
Did you make it, or did your wife make those?
Oh, my wife makes them. Sure. On the shop.
That's wonderful.
Joe, what kind of material is that made out of? The thing with the keys?
The tile?
It's tiles. Oh, okay. Gosh, love that.
So they cut glass and they cut. And then this one is the recent one she made for the Ukrainian war. In fact, she just came back from Ukraine, from Poland last night.
Oh, she made it home safe, Joe?
Yeah, she came in. She came home safely. Yeah, she was there. She went actually to work with the Ukrainian kids who are refugees in Poland. So she did art with them. They did art with them for 2 weeks. So she made this. They made some of this Ukrainian. This is a sign of a Ukrainian flag or something of that sort. Yeah, so they did things like this at that camp. Yeah.
Oh, that's wonderful. And so symbolic.
Yeah.
So that's wonderful she was able to do that with the kids, because that helps ground them too when they're going through a really difficult time.
It does. In fact, they had a very good time with them, and the kids were suffering from PTSD already. Just the slightest pop of a balloon at that camp, they will be so activated. So they're thinking of what's happening back home, and they left yesterday with a lot of mixed emotions, because those kids will be going back to Ukraine most of them were going back in on the 13th.
Right.
Yeah.
Wow. But it's so healthy for them because they were able to make art with things that bring them joy and things right. that remind them of home. So see how symbolic that can be and how grounding it is because they're having to make all those details and think about it, yet they are able to talk to each other while they're doing it and enjoy each other's company. That's so cool, Joe. Thank you for, Joseph, for telling us about that.
I think
one of the things that got me, because I saw Joe in the office last week when he was here, and he was talking about what his wife was doing, is not realizing that her purpose to go there was to give him a distraction for a minute, you know, and being able to get their minds off of what they were going through for that minute, you know. And I think that we don't give enough mindfulness to how easy it can be to color with somebody, you know, doing these different things. With the client to kind of get those emotions kind of out of them and help them processing it for the healing.
Right.
So I think that was the best thing is when I was hearing Joe say his wife and what she was doing, just, she's just trying to make the kids smile for a minute.
It is. And it's so healthy for them too, because it's working through their, helping them process everything that's going on in a really healthy way.
Yeah.
It's not necessarily blurting it all out, but it's just being able to give them time to think and be in the moment.
Yep.
Yeah.
Right.
That's awesome. Thank you for sharing that.
Very welcome.
Well, I'm going to zip through some of these other ones. This is taking me longer than I thought it would, but apparently I've got lots of interesting projects that you can do. So they had a worry jar or box or a happiness jar or box that you can put you can make a jar out of like paper mache where you take strips of paper and dip them in like water mixed with flour and then coat like something like you could have like a tub, like a little plastic tub and coat it with this paper mache. And then they put things that they worry about in it. And then you put the lid on the jar and look at that. You don't have to worry about it anymore. It's in the jar. If you feel like you need to worry one day, then you can take the lid out and look at all of them. But you, the nice thing about it, if you put it in a jar, there's something about when you write something down and cover it that's very representative of what your mind is doing. So you kind of, then you can kind of do your self-talk. I already put that in the jar. I'm not going to worry about it. When it comes back into your mind, you can kind of say, nope, I'm not going to worry about that. Same with the happiness jar. You know, to just continually put happy thoughts in a big jar. When my kids were little, we used to do at Thanksgiving, we would all like the whole month of December, or sorry, November, which is, you know, Thanksgiving's at the end of the month. We would every night at dinner, we'd write something we're thankful for. And it couldn't be that something they had written recently or in recent years. So you couldn't just write mom, dad, dog, you know, all that kind of stuff. They had to actually go a little deeper. And then we would read them when we pulled it out the next November. And it was so fun to go back and relive some of their instances and experiences that they remembered. I learned how to ride a bike. It made me so happy. Oh, I remember I got straight A's, so I got to pick out a pet. My daughter picked out chickens. I was like, okay. Or, you know, whatever it may be that brought them happiness. And so sometimes it's nice to be able to have something where you put your things that bring you joy so that when you're having times of anxiety or you're having a tough time or just a dark day, you pull those out and then find joy, realize there is joy in life and whatnot. So just a thought. So you can making the jar be the activity, or you can have it, the activity being putting things in the jar. So, or you can do both. So anyway, this was a really interesting one. I don't know if you guys have heard of this grief pot before. Let me see if I can find my notes on it really quick, just because it was so unusual. What they suggested doing was getting a terracotta pot, and in a paper bag, you gently tap the edges of it and break it. And then you take the pieces out, not lots of little pieces, but like bunches of pieces, like maybe 10 pieces. And then you, inside the pot, you put, this is especially good for grief, so it's called a grief plot. So you write the things that you've lost on the inside. If your family went through a fire, you write down all the things that you lost, your safety, your security, your favorite photos, whatever it is. If it's a person, you write, you know, their friendship, their the time you spent with them, there for the holidays, whatever it is that you lost on the inside pieces of the pot. And then you glue it back together. And then on the outside, you write about the things that you still have or have gained from the loss. So like if it was grandma that you put on the inside, then you might put, we still have her recipes. We still have her favorite books that she used to read to the kids. We still have her, I don't know, blankets she crocheted for us. Whatever it may be, that, but that's kind of the idea of it. And then when you glue it back together, you can kind of see the fragments of it still. It's not perfect. But then when you look inside or on the outside, you see that the things that you have on the outside that you still have, it still keeps the pot together. So you don't have to lose yourself inside of it. You can kind of look at the outside of it and realize that even though this person's gone or I've lost something of great value, I still can continue moving on. So I thought that was really interesting. I had never heard of anything quite like that. photography is actually another great idea to get people. It'd be a great assignment even to do photography. You could do like find 10 things that are green. If a person really needs to be grounded during the week, you could say, you know what, if you're having a tough day, go out and find 10 green things, or find find 10 things that are round, or 10 things that make you happy, or you could do like a scavenger hunt, or you could do 10 things that represent anger, or 10 things that represent joy. Or another thing you do is like compare things from blurry to focus. So take a picture of something blurry and then put it into focus, and then kind of talks about depth and noticing the details of things. Sometimes when we're all up in our head, we don't see the details. We just kind of see the gist of everything and everything's overwhelming. Whereas when you photograph something blurry, you actually have to work at it these days. So there's so many automatic self-correcting things. So you, to get it blurry, and then you're like, oh, and then you can maybe take a picture of it clearer too. Kind of really working on people getting mindful. So, you know, trying to make sure that they're, you could also do things with social justice, things that, pictures that might demonstrate a thought or an assumption. Like, what would you think about when you see a picture? You know, you could kind of talk about what's happening in this picture. You could do like a scavenger hunt, you know, have 10 things you want them to take pictures of their phone with, and they'd be places they have to go. Take a picture of water, flowing water, or take a picture of a bird, which is kind of tricky because you have to be real stealthy. So you could, you know, come up with little things like that. Yeah, so lots of things you could do with photography. And the great thing is nowadays, you know, back in the day, we had to hope for the best when we turned our pictures into Costco or whatever, that some of them would turn out. But nowadays, you know, we all have thousands of them on our phones. So you could have, each week you could have a different type of assignment for them to find things. And so every day they could have a little something that they have to look for that would kind of give them something, purpose to get out of bed, purpose to get on with their day. Maybe it's something good, something that makes them smile. So yeah, the next one, a terrarium, was kind of fun. I've got kids that are very into plants. In fact, my one daughter brings hers home from college and it literally fills her car and then fills my entire dining room table and my whole front room. And then there's all these instructions. So it's a little crazy. So you could do, to do a terrarium would be expensive probably to do with a client, but you could do like an image in a bottle or something like that, or they could purchase the things to put in a terrarium. A terrarium is just a container like an aquarium or like a big vase or something where you put a little dirt on the bottom and then you plant plants in it. And that's kind of a like a nice earthy way to get their hands dirty or things like that. Feeling, smelling the soil, feeling the plants, and it's, you know, it's healing properties with that. But you could also do like a diorama and actually just have a shoebox and put pictures of plants in it, or you could have them draw pictures of plants, or you could have them draw a picture of their safe place and do it like a diorama of that, or have like a type of thing like that, or what heaven looks like, or what life in 2 years would look like, or the best things in their life. So there's lots of things you can do with it, like a terrarium idea. The motivational button are just those little stick-on buttons that you pin on. Just having something, you could have like the 10 steps that you need to do to de-escalate situations or your mood. You could have them be things that make them happy, snarky sayings that kind of make them laugh. But you can just, and I didn't know about this about them, but apparently you can just pop off the back of them and put new things on the back too. So once you get tired of one set of things, you can have a different set of things. So you could have one each day or one each week. You could have rewards or accomplishments or things that you, maybe your clients have done. Happy, strengths, grateful, things they're grateful for. You have 30 for a month. You change them out like a different activity to do a day, each day to be thankful or mindful. Okay, so I do have a whole bunch more of these, but I'm going to kind of skip through the, oh, some of these are kind of good though. Sorry, this lighthouse one was actually really good. So you just take a picture, like even like a coloring book picture of a lighthouse. And as they're coloring it, you have them talk about where they would be. Would they be in the water? Would they be half dead on a rock out there in the middle of the ocean? Would they be in a boat? Would they be, and then you talk about who is a lighthouse to you? What does that represent? Who's that safety? Who is the, and so you kind of see where, you know, instead of saying, well, fist to five, how are you feeling today? You just say, oh, where are you by the lighthouse today? Are you safe in the lighthouse? Or are you on the shores running to the lighthouse? Are you still struggling out in the water? So I thought that was a great visual for someone who really can't talk about their situation, where they've been maybe. Let's see, daisy chain is just those little like things you used to make at holidays where you take strips of paper and stick them together and you can put lists. You can have, try and have like where you take off one each day and you, have goals on them or things that you're trying to do or activities that you want to try and do. I thought the self-care box was kind of cool to put things in a box that you might need if you are having a hard time getting out of bed and you know it's going to be a day that you're just going to have a tough time getting through, maybe migraine, whatever it is, but it's a self-care box. So in that box, you would put, let's say maybe you'd put maybe some essential oils or a candle or a book that makes you, that you could read to look forward to, a soft blanket, a devotional or something that would, maybe tissues, maybe a face mask or a
tea bag,
something that would be comfy, so, maybe just tea. Maybe some chocolate, but something that you could pull out so that when you're having a tough day, you actually have something to look forward to. So it's not just gonna be a tough day. It's like, oh, good, I get to take out my self-care box. One thing that's kind of funny is when I was teaching, they had started putting together like earthquake kits. And when we did the earthquake drill the first time, the kids at the end, they're like, yay, we get to eat our earthquake kit now. It's like, no, it's for emergencies. But they thought, well, this was what it was for, the earthquake. We just had the pretend earthquake. So they were all disappointed. They couldn't eat the candy bar and the other earthquake kits. But there's a couple other two here, two or three that I wanted to go over. One of them is a balance. And I thought this was so interesting. You can take, so if you have someone that's having a really tough time making a decision, do I stay in this marriage or do I leave? Or do I go on to get a college education, or do I continue where I am? Do I change jobs? Do I, you know, whatever it may be, is the time to have kids or not? And what you do is you just kind of have either something simple like a coat hanger, and you can just clip on two buckets on either side, and you can use rocks, and you have bigger rocks and you have smaller rocks, and you have them write the different things on it. Because some, you know, you can do when you do pros and cons in a list, they don't have weight to them. Whereas if you do the rocks in something like that, you know, like going to college, you would increase your pay and things like that, but you lose a lot of family time. And so you kind of have to weigh different weights for each thing. So I thought that was a kind of a neat one to think about. The other one I kind of liked was for the balancing, they used like a coat hanger with two plastic cups hanging from it, or like stones or marbles with different sizes or coins. Where you can have decorate one side happy, one side sad, pros and cons of something, just kind of give people a visual sense. But the other one was the eggs. This was really a clever idea. You just get those big plastic Easter eggs that pull apart, that are the bigger ones. And inside, they use it for distress tolerance. So we're like anger, you write out anger, the word anger on the outside. And then you put strips of paper of like, maybe they can write 10 different things that can help de-escalate their situation. So, you know, of course, breathing, or taking a walk, or looking at a funny meme video or something, or talking to a friend, or taking a little drive. So I thought that was a great idea, because if you have a person that has lots of different issues, sometimes those little eggs, it kind of gives them something physical to think, oh my goodness, I am so angry. I'm going to just open this up and I can take something out. And
you mean like inside the egg would be little pieces of paper?
Right, with all the ideas on it. Yeah, okay. And so then they can stick them back in so you don't use it over and over again. But it'd be great in a family if you're having trouble, if you have a child that struggles with anger issues or disrespectfulness, or making, just have, you know, different ways to apologize. I mean, there's a lot of things you could put on the outside depending on what the situation is. And I thought that was kind of a great idea. You could put somebody's name on the outside and then put all the positive qualities about them. It's like in a group kind of a setting or something. You could put goals, 10 different steps to achieve a goal, and, you know, pull out one every day to remind yourself, okay, if I want to lose these 10 pounds, I am going to go on a walk today. I'm going to eat healthy. I'm going to drink more water, that kind of thing. So that's kind of that one. Let's see, there's a recipe box is like a recipe. You would write how much do you need of different things. Like you think of a, they use the idea for like grief or goal setting or communication being a positive feeling. So you do like you would for meatloaf, the recipe would have courage and happiness, or comfort when sad, or I didn't understand that one as well, I guess, maybe. The fortune teller one isn't actually just like you think of crystal ball fortune teller. It's those little paper things that we used to do as kids, where you like, you go choop, 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 and you say, pick a number, choop, 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 pick another number or letter or something, you go 1, 2, 3, 4. And then you open it up, and then it has like 8 different things that you can write on the inside that are positive, or they could be words of affirmation, or good things about me, or coping skills, or mood, attitude, focusing, or mindful awareness. Something they could do: tap your hands, or stamp your fingers, or jump around, or get your energy out. So I thought that was kind of a fun one. So I know as a kid, you used to make those a lot. They're not very hard to make, but you can look online and there's like, they'll do a step-by-step for you in case you don't. I made so many of them when I was a kid that comes right back to me. I should have made one just so you could see it. Let's see, what's up in the coaster? Oh, coasters were just reminders, like for grief, you could put grandma's picture on a set of coasters, or you could have like you could do them on tiles, or you put photos over them and put shellac on top. You things that you, because you would have it out all the time to put your cups on. So you could put leaves or drawings or wrapping paper or things that make you happy, notable quotes for theme. And one person even talked about putting coasters together to make a puzzle. I don't know if I would like that, but it's a clever idea because, you know, like you take a coaster out each time and you add it to the other one or something. But those are kind of like a positive, uplifting thing that you could do together to help the person remind them of the things that they have in their life that are good to think about and to like. Alphabet balloons. Oh, I gotta find the balloon one. Sorry, some of these are out of order. The balloon one wasn't what I thought it was gonna be. So let me see if I can find it. So this was, and I thought this was a great explanation for things, especially if you've got kids or people in your life. So it's a visual, kind of a fun visual for like that saying, it took the wind out of my sails, gave me no more energy, or, you know, for emotions and things like that. So you'd be like, if you had a group and they were struggling with emotions, of course, everybody does. So on each balloon, you could write, like on the red balloon, you could write anger, or another balloon, you could write happiness, or no, you're writing all negative ones. And then they're supposed to be keeping them up in the air, like as a game. And then you throw in, after there's like several that they're juggling, you throw in happiness. And typically what happens is like, it just gets lost in the thing. They're like, oh, we didn't even notice you threw in happiness, because it kind of is a great visual to say that when you are overwhelmed with your emotions, it's really hard to find the happiness unless you're looking for it. And so I thought that was a great, great visual to let people know that when you are feeling all these emotions, that's the time where you really have to seek happiness for yourself so that you can get through the emotional stage to the other side. I thought that was kind of an interesting example to kind of point that out to somebody. Let's see, snowflakes is just, we're all like snowflakes, each part's different. So you could put people's names on a snowflake and everybody writes something nice about them, or you could have their name on a snowflake and they can write things nice about themselves, that kind of thing. I think I actually went through all of these. Wow, okay, awesome, moving along. So why would we do all of these unusual things? It helps people express emotions when they're maybe overwhelmed and they don't know how to put into words what they're feeling, because there's so much, you know, you kind of have to pick it apart little by little. It enhances mindfulness, it increases happiness, it improves interpersonal communication, it enhances fine motor and gross motor skills. It develops self-esteem, and it teaches teamwork. So a lot of these activities could be done with more than one person. And notice most of them, you don't even have to buy something. It'd be stuff you just have around your house or in your recycle box or things like that. But it's amazing how just by doing something a little different, it will help people get outside themselves. Like you were saying with the drawing thing, it's like, wow, I haven't done this for a long time. Just because you haven't done it doesn't mean you can't enjoy doing it. These are some of the different YouTubes and stuff I did. So I was going to just kind of quickly ask, was there any takeaways that anybody thought they could, would want to talk about, or anything that resonated with them, or something that you think you might be able to use when working with your family or with clients or things like that?
Lori, I have I have a niece that's an art therapist, and when our daughter was murdered, she took a photograph and she drew a pencil drawing of her face based on the photograph, and then she asked everybody to email her words that described our daughter. And then, and so she, then she wrote those words around the picture. Can you not hear me? I cannot hear you, Veronica. Can you guys hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay. Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. So anyway, she wrote the words that described her around the picture and then framed it for us. And so it was a very therapeutic for our family. And so it hangs in, on the wall in our house. So, you know, all of our family members, when they come and go, they can see this picture of our daughter and those words describing her. So that was really a special piece of art therapy that was done for us. I mean, we didn't do it, but it was done for us. But I was thinking it would be something that could be done, like if someone is grieving someone who they lost, they could bring a picture to therapy, and then, you know, we could help them write descriptive words around their picture and frame it for them.
Can you guys hear me now? Hello? Deanna, will you talk?
I can hear you now.
I can hear you guys.
I am sorry. We heard
her. I forgot to keep my computer logged in. Sorry, you guys.
Turn it back.
I guess we want to see you, don't we?
And then, so I am so sorry, Deanna. Can you just briefly synopsis about your daughter?
Oh, okay. So yeah, I just was saying that this wasn't an art therapy project that we actually did, but my niece, who is a therapist, an art therapist, she took a picture of our daughter, and the week or two after our daughter was murdered, she asked families and friends to text her words that described our daughter that we lost. Uh-huh. And so then she took all those words and wrote that around the picture.
How beautiful.
And then she framed it in at her memorial. She gave us that, and so it hangs on the wall in our house, so when people come and go, they always see that, which is really awesome. And then so I was just saying that that was something she did for us. But I'm thinking, if someone has suffered a loss and they're in therapy, that's something they could do, is take a picture of their lost one and write words around it that describe them.
I love that. I love that. That's so beautiful. Thank you for sharing that. Mm-hmm.
I have a sister who is a bipolar schizophrenic.
Can you guys hear Veronica?
Yes.
Okay, good.
And she cannot do regular therapy. It just does not, it just doesn't work for her. Sitting and talking and doing that, it's just, it doesn't work for her. But what she got an art therapist, and she would come to the house and just bring art supplies for them to paint or to color or whatever. And that's how they would do their therapy. And they wouldn't start out talking at all. You'd just see her, give her the colors. And then she just had this way, she would watch her change how she was coloring, because there were times where she was like really into it and making her lines pretty and making it flow. And then there's other times where she'd get like childlike and hold the crayons like a child and start scribbling all over the place. And as she built the relationship with her during those times when she'd start coloring like a child, you know, she would talk to her like, what's going on? Are we scared? Are we running? Are we? And there was just some way of, by her coloring, she would start talking to her. She wouldn't take her eyes off the page. She would just color and talk. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Once she stopped coloring, she'd stop talking.
Interesting.
And so for her, that's how they were able to do therapy. Now, they had tried sitting her down and doing those different ones. But there was just that, there's something about that disconnecting, you know, in the present.
It's almost like they don't realize they're talking.
Yes. So, yes. Yeah.
Thank you for sharing. Anybody else have any takeaways from any of these things? Or any thoughts? Okay. Well, we'll kind of just wrap things up then. I encourage you to try one or two of these things, whether it's with a friend or with family, or just even trying yourself, and see if you can find calmness in them or doing something with these. I think the main thing is that it just, like Veronica said, it just calms your soul. It kind of helps you to your client, or for you to be able to not be in your anxious self, but to just calmly talk about things and find your point of view and keep you grounded. And Cindy, I know, talks a lot about making sure our clients, you know, end on a happy note, and that they can stay grounded in the middle of it as well. So I sure appreciate everybody sticking with us with all of our different challenges that we had. Are we still recording?
Oh, yeah, we're still recording.
So I do appreciate that, and I do appreciate you staying to learn about your art therapy. There's lots of things that art therapy does for people that we know about, but we also know there's a lot that it does for people that we don't know about. Maybe it will create a new hobby for them. Maybe it'll start being a lifelong something that they enjoy doing. One of the things that was on there that I didn't mention was like crocheting or finger crocheting, doing something with your hands, you know, connecting paper clips or
rubber bands or things like that. So there's lots of things that you can do that aren't stressful or very lead, or just, you know, even putting supplies out for your clients that they might be interested in doing while they're in your office would be great. You know, whether it's a coloring book that they could just pick up and just start coloring on if they want to. And I think that that's, it's just a different way of doing what we already do, but maybe enhancing it, maybe tapping into somebody and connecting with somebody in a different way. So I'm hoping you guys will take some of these ideas and run with them and just kind of think about them. There's lots of great resources online. If you're, all you have to do is look up art therapy ideas, and they are lots of them. So I just encourage you to do that if you're interested. But thank you so much. Let's close in prayer before we go. Lord, I just thank you so much for each of these patient people. I just thank you that we could meet together today to expand on what we know. And thank you for all the wonderful things that Cindy and Elsa Jane have taught us over the years. Thank you that we can use our talents and gifts to honor you, Father. I just pray that you give us insight and wisdom when we're working with people, whether it's a formal client, whether it's a friend, whether it's someone at the grocery store, that we can just really, really open our eyes to how we can help people and tap into ways to get them healthy. And we thank you for that. We just thank you that we get to come here and learn and then share what we've learned with other people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So thank you, my friends, for coming.
Thank you, Lori, for teaching us. And you know what I was thinking about? The jar, the self-care jar.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe having them write affirmation things to themselves to put in the jar. So when they're dealing with self-esteem, they can pull those out too.
Great idea.
Thank you, Lori.
Thank you for coming. Have a great week.
I was going to say, just so you guys know, this is our, we've got two more classes before graduation. So we're getting close to the end.
Wow.
Yeah. May 26th will be graduation, so it won't even be a true class. So we've got a parable, and then I don't know what Cindy's teaching on, but we have one more parable. So we're just about wrapping up the end of the year. If you guys got assignments or things to turn in, I would do so now, because I'm already working on graduation certificates, as I showed you guys earlier tonight. So we're getting ready for graduation.
And she does like it if you say something at graduation.
Yes.
So maybe be thinking of things that have touched your heart, things that you want to try.
And invite your family members. Last year when I did my level one, we did it on Zoom, and I had my family around me on Zoom. So I know Cindy will give that time. If you're not in person, to have you guys with your family members on Zoom so that they can kind of celebrate, you know, the accomplishment, because level two, you guys, that's a pretty big deal that we got it done.
It is amazing.
So that's all I got.
Yeah. And it was one more thing I wanted to add. Now that I've been working with clients, just remember that they are coming to have you help them. And I know it's kind of scary to think about, you've got this person's cares and worries in your hands, but I just, that was the thing I was probably worried about the most before I had clients. And I gotta say, God shows up every time, and I always come away from them lighter than when I started, which is like, doesn't even make sense, because I am one of those people that cares too much, and it just bogs me down because I worry about their problems. But God is so good, and he will step in and help you. When you need the help, he'll give you the words to say. You think, wow, I got to be listening to this, because whatever I'm saying is really good, and I'm hoping they're listening, because God's tapping in. So I just wanted to encourage you with that, that it is really scary to start doing clients. But the things that I've learned from Cindy have been so very helpful and so such a blessing. I think I've used almost everything. The grounding is probably one of the most important things to end. You know, I have one of the gals show me grandkid pictures at the end. I got to see extra grandkid pictures. You got to have some on there. They're new. And sure enough, she always does. Or something like that. So they don't leave the session all in a tizzy. So good to know. But anyway, have a great week. We love you all, and it was so great to see you guys again. So that was wonderful.
Thank you, Lori.
Yeah, take care.
I'll see you on Monday, Deanna.
Bye. Good.
Bye-bye. Bye.
This is Ariana.
Yeah, hi. Hi,
Ariana.
Hi. I'm really not sure. We might get the certificate of level 1 or 2.
Are you in both, Ariana? Or are you? You know what? I'll have to look and I'll have somebody get with you because I know that I saw your name on a list.
Thank you.
So,
and I'm not done with my level 2's homework. I have to do some more, and I'm sending some, but still I have to work on.
Well, perfect. And you know, Cindy's keeping an eye on that stuff, so we'll definitely get you, you know, get it taken care of.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, for sure.
Bye-bye. Thank you so much. Bye.
All right, have a good week, you guys. Okay, so first we got this. Stop recording.
Thank you. I am so glad you were.